Apparently, the Biden administration facing mounting pressure over its border policies, including a new plan to pay out to illegal immigrants. The proposed plan would reportedly send 450 million $450,000 taxpayer dollars per person to families who were separated at our southern border. Here to react, House Judiciary Committee member and author of the upcoming book, Do What You Said You Would Do, Fighting for Freedom in the Swamp, Congressman Jim Jordan. Jim, good morning to you.
Good to be with you, Steve.
Okay, so the Wall Street Journal broke this story that apparently the administration considering essentially paying at least $1 million per family to these migrant families who were impacted by President Trump's zero tolerance policy at the southern border, where when a family unit was taken into custody, you can't keep the kids with the adults, so they put them in separate places, and some of them got separated permanently.
Kelly, at this stage, there are more questions than answers, and sources caution that so many of those final details, whether how the program will work or how much money will be paid, are yet to be determined. This is an ongoing settlement negotiation between the U.S. government and lawyers representing those families who were separated, over 5,600 of them, by the Trump administration in what, remember, Physicians for Human Rights, a Nobel laureate organization and nonprofit, deemed torture. It met the UN's definition, as well as the American Academy of Pediatrics, who called this government-sanctioned child abuse at the time. And so when you hear from the former vice president today criticizing the potential settlement, you have to keep all of this in context. But what we are hearing, and sources have told NBC News, is that the sum could be significant. It could be hundreds of thousands of dollars each, which, of course, could amount to hundreds of millions of dollars if all of the families who were separated by this policy are included. It's also important to note that this is separate and distinct from the reunification effort that's underway and being led by the Biden administration through that Family Separation Reunification Task Force. This is a civil case, a tort case being brought against the U.S. government for damages that these families endured as they were separated, oftentimes for many, many months. Some still, 1,000 of those families remain separated to this day. Around 300 families have yet to be located by those searching for them right now. And it's part of why all of this is still so challenging and a developing situation.
Tonight, the Biden administration negotiating what could be a financial settlement of hundreds of millions of dollars for families who were torn apart. The talks ongoing between the Justice Department and lawyers representing thousands of migrant parents and children who were separated at the U.S. border during the Trump administration. A number of tort cases claiming the families experienced harm when they were forcibly separated. Three sources familiar with ongoing negotiations tell NBC News that on the table are what for some separated families could be payments of hundreds of thousands of dollars per person in compensation. The Wall Street Journal first reported on Thursday that the Biden administration's in talks to offer significant financial compensation for what the families endured. Sources caution the settlement negotiations aren't final. Former Vice President Mike Pence today lashing out at word of possible compensation for those separated by his administration's policy.
This incomprehensibly stupid idea of passing out up to $500,000 to people whose first act in this country was a violation of our law makes no sense at all.
Under former President Donald Trump's Zero Tolerance Initiative in 2018 and a pilot program in 2017, more than 5,600 kids were separated from their parents after crossing the border both at and in between ports of entry. Many held in cages at the Central Processing Center in McAllen, Texas, as we reported at the time.
People in here are locked up in cages, essentially what look like animal kennels. I don't know any other way to describe it.
Until the policy, crossing the border illegally, a misdemeanor under U.S. law, didn't result in parents who crossed with kids being federally prosecuted and separated from their children. President Biden, as a candidate, was harshly critical of the family separation policy.
It's criminal. It's criminal.
As president-elect, he promised accountability and a thorough investigation of the policy. And once inaugurated, created a task force to reunite the families. Today, more than 1,000 families are estimated to still be separated from each other, according to the White House. In many cases, the parents were deported back to their home countries while their children remained in the U.S. In May, we spoke with Brian Chavez, the day before he became the first person separated during the Trump administration, reunited by the Biden administration.
It's just a really cruel experience that I just hope no one has to go through.
So far, the task force has been able to reunite around 50 families, with the White House saying many more will take place soon. Lawyers representing families like Brian's hope that's the case and that the Biden administration agrees to allow deported parents to return to the United States on a permanent basis. The payments under negotiation could go to the separated parents and children, whether they're in the U.S. or Central America. Sources involved in those negotiations worry leaked details of them aren't only creating confusion for families separated, but make them a target of crime as well. Now, those families who have endured so much, again, looking for answers.
Jacob Soboroff joins us now from Los Angeles, and Jacob has done so much reporting on this issue. So I have to ask you, we just heard from the former vice president there, and he threw out that number, $500,000. There's been some reporting about the exact number. I know it's still unclear. But Jacob, how do you put a price tag for the families that have suffered this torture, both the children and the parents?
I think it's almost impossible, Tom, and you use the word torture. That's the exact language that Physicians for Human Rights, the Nobel Laureate organization, has called this. American Academy of Pediatrics called it government-sanctioned child abuse. You and I covered this together almost shoulder to shoulder at the time down there in both Brownsville and McAllen, Texas. And what the people close to the victims and those separated will tell you is that there is no price to pay that can right the wrong of the family separation policy. And that is why there is so much caution that the fact that these negotiations are not final and that there are consequences to the negotiations even leaking out right now.
So what's been the reaction from the families and those NGOs who have been working with these parents to sort of reunite them with their children?
I think it's mixed, Tom. I think that there's cautious optimism that perhaps these families could be compensated for something that, they say no human being should ever have to go through. But there's also great fear in their home countries in Central America that this could make them, the announcement, the target of potential crime. And also the fact that this may not happen at all. And that's getting the hopes up of people who have been through just really what is truly an unspeakable tragedy.
Reparations as a way to make amends for the atrocities of slavery and to reduce the persistent wealth gap has recently gained momentum.
$14 trillion in reparation is an appropriate statement.
Black Americans possess 2.6% of the nation's wealth, but make up 13% of the population.
That racial wealth gap is a starting place for any reparations program.
A number of states, towns, and institutions have begun to grapple with the idea. As of August 12, 142 Congress members have co-sponsored H.R. 40, the bill that establishes a commission to study reparations. That is compared to only two in 2014. Even Joe Biden has said he supports the bill, but a real program could be costly.
This hardly seems the time to burden the economy with more debt, more taxes. Essentially, what you want to do is stimulate economic growth for all our benefits.
What would a potential reparations program look like? And can the U.S. afford it? Black Americans lag behind whites in almost every category of economic well-being. They are far less likely to be employed, own their home, inherit money, accumulate wealth, and earn as much as white counterparts. The median net worth of a white household is $171,000. For blacks, it's just a bit over $17,000.
What do we want?
Reparations!
What do we want?
Now!
Though reparations has been studied, practicality has often taken a backseat to morality. scholars who have worked on calculating compensation don't always agree. For about 30 years, William Darity has discussed the rationale and design of reparations. Today, he says it will cost the United States government between $10 trillion and $12 trillion. To put that in perspective, in 2019, the US GDP was about $21.5 trillion. Even Joe Biden has said he supports the bill, but a real program could be costly.
We'll be right back.